don't try to hurry to give an oxygen to the patient. What he requires is nebulization. So whenever acute exacerbation of COPD, sir, I will start with nebulization with Tivoline, whatever the dose I said. So yes, but karato, respirals sangha is to all puts a light pressure. So respirals, QID or every 2 hourly. That is a specific protocol given in the management also. Okay, 2 hourly or every 20 minutes for 5 times in 1 hour. That is what the recommended thing. Have you done it? Every 20 minutes, one respirator till 1 hour is what is required for the patient. I have done it. In when I manage my own patients, pratyek 20 to 1 hour, 20 minutes ala nebulization start, nebulization chalu kara. Once the nebulization is started, if the saturation is low, I will start oxygen. If it is less than 90, and I will try to keep the oxygen level between 92. Then I will ask the sister to put an intra-track, give an injectable hydrocorticosteroid. I will observe the patient. Then I will also give antibiotic to the patient. Right? This is the most important 3 drugs which you have to get to the examinable area. Start, then this practical thing, start nebulization every 20 minutes till the patient settles, or 5 times in a 1 hour. Oxygen in the saturation is low. I will take an IV access, I will give an injectable corticosteroid, hydrocortisone 100 mg, I will start, or MTS 40 mg, I will start. I will also administer an antibiotic with piperacillin tazobactam 450 mg and 100 mg over 1 hour to this patient, and I will observe the patient. Rest, nothing comes, only this is 3 is the important treatments in acute exacerbation. And practically also, this is what is going to settle your patient, nothing else.
And which investigation will ask also?
Then I will advise investigations. What is our investigations?
It's ABG, then chest x-ray, public blood picture down, sputum examination.
Acute exacerbation, you should do the blood sugar, blood urea also.
Diagnosis not meant then.
General routine, but the importance of
different
what will you put an EPG in this patient? And
I will So I will respect this.
What do you expect in this level?
My respiratory is process.
Respiratory?
Acidosis.
Acidosis. And if the oxygen and immunization patient is not coming out or not getting respiratory rate is not, what you will do further? You will not get in response to this
treatment. I will start non-invasive first.
Non-invasive medications for
non-invasive ventilation.
In CO2.
Sir, if PO2 is between 66 to 85 mmHg and RR is more than 26, pH is above 7.25 between.
Above or below?
Sir, for non-invasive, sir, for invasive it is 7.25, below 7.25. And for PO2 is less than 3.
But above 7.25 is what? There has to be range.
Sir, so 7.
7.25 normal for
7.25 to 7.35. Which is already non-invasive ventilation.
What is normal pH range?
Sir, 7.35 to 7.45. But ideal procedure with measure is 7.40 in our practice.
Whatever ranges are like, that's the ideal procedure. 7.35 to 4.5 is the right answer. So 2.5 to 3.5, you have considered NRV.
Yes.
7.25.
Yes. Over range of measure.
7.25 to 3.5.
Okay.
You should know that what are the settings of which is the pressure, respiratory, expiratory, what is everything.
Yeah.
So, one is. One is a clinical criteria and second is the MHG criteria.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
So, straight away, can you put the patient straight away on a non-invasive ventilation? And when will you put this patient on non-invasive ventilation? A patient, oh, your patient is there. Suppose he has an RR of 35. Right?
Yes.
So, tell me practically when you will put this patient on non-invasive ventilation and what will you do? How will you clinically or practically manage this particular patient? You have started nebulization. 1 hour is over. Your hydroxycorticosteroid dose is also given to the patient. And after 1 hour, his RR initially was 40, now it is 35. RR is 35. And accessory muscles of respirations are still working. Whatever the image you sent, the report has come. And it shows the pH of 7.25. And PCO2 of 70. So this is the indication of
non-invasive ventilation. I look at invasive ventilation.
You have not started invasive ventilation. I do not use ventilation yet.
No, so I will go.
Rate is 7.25 to 7.35. You have just given nebulization, and this is the picture. This is the clinical situation. Will you prefer to start NIV first or directly go to medical invasive ventilation?
No, sir, I will go to medical
ventilation.
Why? Sir, PSU is too much. I guess.
2
So important thing is indications feedback right. 1, 2, 3, and when you do that, if your image was the display, say after whether the patient comes to you, then only you are going to start for the ventilation. So this to me as a ये मनता है तसं नका करू नॉन इन्वेजिनेशन ठीक आहे आणि दोन तीन तरी सांगा चांगले क्लिनिकल क्रायटेरिया पीबीसी क्रायटेरिया त्याच्यामध्ये पीएचचा क्रायटेरिया सगळ्यात महत्त्वाचा दर्शन आणि नॉन इन्वेजिव्ह मेकॅनिकल वेंटिलेशन दिल्यानंतर आपण मेकॅनिकल इन्वेजिव्ह वेंटिलेशनला जातो अनलेस इन अंटिल द पेशंट व्हॉट आर द कॉन्ट्रॅडिकेशन्स फॉर एनआय त्याच्यानंतर आपण डायरेक्टली मग जाऊ शकतो कुठले कॉन्ट्रॅडिकेशन सर कडक कॉन्ट्रॅडिकेशन फॉर नॉन इन्वेसिव्ह वेंटिलेशन नॉन कॉन्ट्रॅडिकेशन फॉर एन आय
सर इन केस ऑफ न्यूरोलॉजिकल
लॉस
ड्राउजी पेशंट
हायपोस्टेबल ड्राउजी पेशंट
कंडिशन इज नॉट स्टेबल
कार्डियोपल्मोनरी कॉम्प्रोमाइज हायपो hydrology patients who have been
assumed and hemodynamically stable.
Mogha Gupta takes away.
By his expert.
Drowsy patient who is not following commands is a contraindication for non-invasive ventilation. As a dismayed common contraindication, a patient who is drowsy is a contraindication. So, drowsy patient. Second,
this we can mention the other also, the hypotension.
Hemodynamic instability. Hemodynamic instability. Second, third, at the facial trauma, but rarely get open. COPD patient with facial trauma. Okay.
Claustrophobic patient.
Claustrophobic. How about Khali Diloma? Eight number? Drowsy patients, hemodynamic instability, and third one, claustrophobic patients, and what are the So, indications, contraindications, and ABG. Done. So, acute exacerbation and treatment for the patient.
Okay.
What vaccinations will you advise to this patient?
Sir, H. influenza, streptococcus pneumoniae. H. influenza vaccine, streptococcus pneumoniae vaccine. This is the most common cause that causes exacerbation.
How
will
you
vaccine
there?
Vaccine will be
good.
Then after the patient stabilizes, I will be COVID vaccine.
Okay.
What are the types of pneumovac vaccination?
Sir, polyvalent, 12, 5, part 1, which one is what for?
PCV.
Pentavalent vaccine.
PCV 13,
PCV
23, 30 serotypes,
30
serotypes.
Pneumovac 13, vaccine the type.
Pneumovac 13.
Pneumovac 13, pneumovac also
the PCV. PCV 23. PPV 23 and PPV 23. Any other vaccine has to be given 1 month after the PPV 13?
Yeah, that is correct. But repetition of the vaccine afterwards.
65 years of age maximum, or after 5 years, which is applicable to the patient. If the patient is 55 years, so we'll give him after 60. That is correct. That we'll give him after 65 years, or if he's already 65 years, so we'll give him after 5 years of his. The time should be 5 years. After every 5 years.
Every 5 years you have to repeat.
But after 65 years.
Right. That is correct. But I think for one vaccine it is only one shot is given.
That is PPV 23.
And one vaccine has to be repeated every 5 years. That's what I remember.
You did.
One more time.
You confirm that you went to re-vaccine. Okay. Then you should read the treatment of COPD detail.
Yes.
And of the stable COPD different way. Or if you have the wrong question also, you have to divide it into stable COPD and
And practical also, whenever a patient of COPD moves in an acute exacerbation, first and foremost confirm that is it really an acute exacerbation or something else is there.